rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, he has made me glad. He has made me glad, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has blessed the name. Bless the name of Jesus, praise the name of Jesus. Sing unto the King of Israel. Bless the name of Jesus, praise the name of Jesus. Sing unto the King of Israel. Now sing glory, glory, glory to his name forever. Glory, glory, glory to his name. Bless the name of Jesus, praise the name of Jesus. Sing unto the King of Israel. The name of Jesus, praise the name of Jesus, sing unto the King of Israel. And I sing glory, glory, glory to his name forever. Glory, glory, glory to his name. Bless the name, bless the name of Jesus, praise the name of Jesus, sing unto the King of Israel. The name of Jesus, praise the name of Jesus, sing unto the King of Israel. And I sing glory, glory, glory to his name forever. Glory, 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 oh, singing glory. Stand together. Let's sing out this song, Great in Power. Praise him, you heavens and all that's above. Praise him, you angels and heavenly hosts. Let the whole world praise him. Sun, moon, and bright shining stars. Praise him, you heavens and waters and skies. Let the whole world praise him. Great in power, great in power, great in glory, great in mercy. And heavenly hosts, let the whole world praise him. Praise him, the sun, moon, and bright shining stars. Praise him, you heavens and waters and skies. Let the
up and lift our voice in gratitude and praise unto you, O God. Hallelujah. We're going to sing out this song, Above All. Above all powers, above all kings, above all nations and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Before the world began, above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what your word.
Tonight, have right of way at this place, oh God, minister by your spirit. Amen.
We
want to lift up a number of needs tonight as we open this service praying for Mila Valine. She's undergoing some more treatment, and that her body would respond correctly. There would be complete healing in her little body. Also continuing to lift up Cindy Linklater, needs a touch of God in her body. Dave Gersten, in need of a desperate miracle. Karen as well, that God would touch her. Isaac Marin, sick, needs a healing touch in his body. We're believing God, numbers of new converts that have prayed that God would touch them, make himself real to their lives, and use them to make impact. Numbers of others that are listed for salvation, for healing. We're believing God that God would minister to these needs. Praying for the Glopinas this week in Focus Fire as our one of our staff evangelists, God's blessing and favor. And then the Velasquezes there in Tijuana, that God would help them. Let's remember our upcoming conference, that God would move and even now begin to just cause all the different things that need to take place to take place. We're believing God for the transition there in Brazil with the Vargases and the Marins. God's hand upon that, over that church, even in that time. We're believing God for favor with the building that we're looking at, that God would open supernatural doors, grant us favor, and all the dynamics that would be there, and help us that we would be able to enlarge our tent, that amen, that we'd continue to have more space for people to come in and keep doing what we're doing. Let's remember the Prescott Church, Pastor Greg and the Prescott staff, lifting them up, believing God for our nation. We need a miracle in our land, that God would visit us with an awakening. You're here tonight. You have a need on your heart. You'd signify that with an uplifted hand. Amen. This is more than just going through the motions, but God, we are trusting that you would undertake on the needs of our life for the service tonight. When we're done praying, Xavier's going to come open our service in prayer. Let's pray together right now. Father in heaven, God, we do lift up these needs before you, even by name, God, asking you to undertake in healing power, God. God, Brother Jim Gann, God, Cindy Linklater, God, we're praying, oh God, for Dave Gersten, God, even Karen, God, that you would strengthen our sister, God, little Mila, healing power, God, resurrection life, God, every new convert and believer, God, your hand at work, oh God, in their life.
Yes, Heavenly Father, God, we come before you this night. God, we ask, Lord God, that your presence would rain down in this place. Lord God, every spirit of anxiety, God, depression, God, we ask that you would just be in this place. God, I pray, Lord God, that your Holy Spirit would just sweep across this place. God, help us, Lord God, enlarge our faith. Lord God, we lift up Mila Valine. God, touch her, God. God, I speak resurrecting life. Lord God, I speak, God, healing power upon our congregation. God, help us tonight, God. We are so desperate, God, for your touch, God. God, we are desperate in this time that we are living in, God. You are our only hope, God. We cry out to you, God. God, give us tokens even tonight, Lord God, that you are still, God, that you are still on the throne, God. We give you all the praise, the honor, and the glory in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen. Praise God. Want to welcome you out. Wednesday night, midweek service. It's good to see you in the house of God this evening. Appreciate every one of you, and believing God that God is going to speak to our hearts and lives this evening. Just a couple of different announcements on the horizon. Tomorrow night's our Tempe Town Lake outreach, meeting at the annex at 6:30, and then going out and telling people about Jesus Christ. Saturday, there is the youth rally up in Prescott. The van leaves here at 7:30 in the morning. And so those of you that are wanting to go, if you can sign up on the sign-up list on the back
board that would help us to know who to plan for. Jesse Cluck, our pastor from Guam, is going to be ministering in that. So it should be a Holy Ghost time and be a great time throughout the day. Then locally, our regular 10:30 outreach Saturday morning, and then that evening at 6:30 at Kiwanis Park near the splash pad, it's going to be a movie outreach. And I mentioned it Sunday night. This is actually the testimony of one of our pastors in Australia, Pastor Tony Huang, I think is his name. And so his family immigrated to Australia from Vietnam, got involved in the gang life, but God gloriously set him free. It'll be a powerful testimony, so encourage you, do what you can to bring somebody, and that'll be 6:30 Saturday night at Kiwanis Park. Then Sunday is a Jesus People wedding. Isaac and Michaela are getting married, and so we're rejoicing in that, and I do want to encourage you, be praying. I know in talking with both of them, not just family, but a number of unsaved workmates that are coming out, a number of folks that don't know Jesus. And so, you know, the reason we have Jesus People weddings, number one, we want Jesus to be at work in the marriage, because in this day and age, actually in any day and age, if you don't have God in the marriage, it's rough sailing. But beyond that is that it's actually Jesus that brought the two of them together. And in salvation and in how that plays out. And the hope is that there's going to be people that perhaps wouldn't typically come to a church service, that it could be an opportunity for them to get saved. One of the guys that my daughter works with, it was just telling her he was looking around for places to go on Easter, and kind of comparing the different programs that churches were having. And the sad thing for me is that I could be wrong, but most likely wherever he went, there was no challenge to get saved after all of that. And so, amen. What we have is precious, that we bring people to a decision. And so even in weddings. So hallelujah. And so then that evening will be the farewell service for the Marines. And because there will be cake and so forth in the morning, and it won't be cake and ice cream in the evening, it'll be finger fruit food. And I think they will have a cake, Brazil for Jesus, or something to that effect. But the point is, bear with me here, is that just if you can bring some finger food to the fellowship afterwards, that would be a blessing. If you have any questions on that, you can see Joellen, and she can square you away on that. Praise God. That's all that we have for announcements. A number of other ones you can see, by the way, the new calendars are out. But we want the ushers to come at this time. And as we pause and prepare our hearts to give, you know, Malachi are probably the most famous passage that deals with tithing. Malachi 3:8, God asks through the prophet, will a man rob God? Pastor Mitchell used to stop right there and said, yes, he will, with a smile on his face. Yes, God, amen, and yes, I will rob from you. Back to the text. He says, yet you've robbed me, but you say, in what have we robbed you? In tithes and offerings, you're cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation. Then he brings the solution. He says, bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. And try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it. Goes on, he says, I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes, so that he will not destroy the fruit of your ground, nor shall the vine fail to bear fruit for you in the field, says the Lord of hosts. You know, this lets us know it is possible to rob from God. It's not like you go down to the Circle K and tell the guy or the gal behind the register, give me everything that's in there. Probably in this day and age, not a whole lot of currency. It's not that you go down to the bank and rob the bank. But what it is God puts resources into our hands, and it's actually a test. Will we honor God with the tenth or the tithe? You know, the reality is many times, I can't afford to tithe, or I can't afford to tithe this go around. Can I tell you, you can't afford not to tithe. Because when you violate this principle, it looses the devourer that this passage talks about. And so the solution is that, you know what, God, whether I have a little, whether I have a lot, I'm going to honor you in your portion, the tithe, offerings besides. As I do that, God, I have a confidence that I can come before you, ask you to undertake on my behalf, ask you to get involved in rebuking the devourer, asking you to open the windows of heaven. You know, I don't do this all the time, but I was praying for somebody recently to get healed in their body. Are you a tither? So why would you ask that? Because some sickness is connected to not tithing. Or it opens the door that the devil exploits. This person said, I am. I said, that's what I thought. The reason I asked, you can ask God to get involved, rebuke the devourer on your body. And God touched and healed their body. Another person that had some circumstances with reversals in life. And again, are you a tither? Yes, I am. Okay, then you know what? We're going to stand on that. Bring that before God, because God said, you can test me in this. The only place in the Word of God. So listen, don't go for the devil's lie. Number one is honor God. It's not an issue of whether you can afford to. You can't afford not to. Number two, if you've entered into this, you've addressed the obedience issue, you have a right to stand on God's word and believe God for his blessing on your behalf. Let's bow our heads across this place. And as we would pause, Brother Nick Rice, if you could ask the blessing on the gift and on the giver. Amen. God bless you in your giving.
I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. Rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad.
Thank God. Appreciate all those that labored on the song service and worship team. If you have your Bibles, Exodus chapter 20. Exodus chapter 20, fairly well-known story from church history, recent church history at that, at least in our fellowship circles, is October 8th, 1871. It was D.L. Moody, who is preaching a Sunday evening service, and the particular title of his message that night was, "What Will You Do with the Christ?" And the strategy that D.L. Moody had was, that night he was going to preach about all the things that you should not do with Jesus. And so he's carefully making his case as he laid out all those different things that you shouldn't do with Christ. Then as the crowd was fully enraptured in his message, teetering on the edge, he brought it to the close, stopped the sermon, and said, next Sunday night, come back and I will finish my sermon. What I want you to do is spend the week praying about what you would do or should do with Jesus. He dismissed the service, and as you recall, it's October 8th, 1871, and it was on that night that the great Chicago fire swept through the city of Chicago, devastated it. In fact, there were many even in that service that evening that went into eternity. Because of that, D.L. Moody made a vow before God. He said, I will never preach a sermon again without giving an altar call. I want to preach on a call to the altar, the grand finale, because altar calls are absolutely critical to what we do. And I believe it's important to focus and perhaps refocus on the importance of altar calls in our services. This is one of the things that our fellowship has fought for and fought to continue and hold on to. I mentioned in the announcements, one of my daughter's coworkers goes to this huge church, and there's some semblance of the gospel that's given, some semblance of a presentation of the Bible, but more and more churches have absolutely done away with altar calls. And so we recognize, wasn't it exciting on Sunday morning, amen, Sunday evening perhaps too, is that there are people that responded, gave their lives to Jesus Christ. You know, what I love to see is when it's a chain reaction, where it's people that perhaps even recently in the last year or so, they bowed their knee to Jesus Christ, gave their lives to Jesus. Now they're telling friends and family members and acquaintances, why don't you come out? And so even this Sunday morning, the chain reaction of, yeah, so-and-so told me about it. I came out and they responded. How many of you know that is just... If you can't get excited about that, man, come up and we'll lay hands on you suddenly. And so we recognize the altar is a place for sinners where backsliders can publicly respond to get right with Jesus. But another thing that sometimes we overlook or miss is that right behind that, altar calls are not just for sinners and backsliders, therefore save sinners, also known as you and me, the saints. That it's not just that, you know, some people have this mistaken idea of the altar is just for people that have royally messed up. That's for bad people. Actually, the altar, if you frequent it, can be preventative medicine and keep you from royally messing up, because God has already gotten a hold of your heart. And so we can publicly pay lip service to the need for the altar. That's what we do at the door. That's what we do in the fellowship. But if we're not careful, we can drift away from it. And perhaps even as time goes on, it's a long time since we've come to the altar. So a call to the altar, Exodus 20, 24 through 26, an altar of earth you shall make for me, and you shall sacrifice on it your burnt offerings and your peace offerings, your sheep and your oxen. In every place where I record my name, I will come to you and I will bless you. And if you make me an altar of stone, you shall not build it of hewn stone. For if you use your tool on it, you have profaned it. Nor shall you go up by steps to my altar, that your nakedness may not be exposed on it. A call to the altar, or the grand finale. Let's start with the simplicity of the altar. So we're thinking about the altar call and the altar. Altars in the Bible historically are a place where God meets with man. The Christian life is not always a mountaintop experience, right? It's not like we're in this continual cloud of God's presence where there's not a care in life, where we're just swept along by the breath of the Holy Spirit, bless His holy name, and ne'er a problem in the world. Right? Thank God for those experiences. We get to have those moments. But the truth is, a lot of life is in the valley. We're laboring in this lost world. We're doing something for God. And so here's the altar in the Bible. The altar was a place where man visited. He did not live there. He did not dwell there all the time. But it's a place where man was able to meet with God. As you study it out, altars were often reference points. That is a place where God met me, where God helped me. In the Old Testament, the altar was a raised place. In other words, again, there's a reference. Something happened here, and it was a place of sacrifice and slaughter. So all of these, it's a place where God meets with man. In the Old Testament, Genesis 12, we have the altar at Bethel. Abraham has an encounter with God, and we know that this altar, Bethel, becomes a reference point throughout the entire Old Testament. Abraham's grandson, Jacob, unknowingly sets an altar of stone in this same place after seeing the ladder going up to heaven. You remember the story, right? Angels ascending and descending. He wakes up. He says, God is in this place. I didn't know it. And so what does he do? He makes an altar. Listen, we need altars in our life. We need a place that is unlike any other place, a place where we can go and meet with God, have an encounter with God in a place that is outside the norm. In other words, it's outside the day-to-day, the ho-hum, the status quo is that, you know what? That's where I go. I go to meet with God and where God can meet with me. Where God can help us. An altar is where God can speak to our lives. Again, as you read through the Bible, Noah was an altar builder. Abraham, I already mentioned, Elijah, David, Elisha, were all altar builders. In Joshua, we have even the story of the 2.5 tribes that decided to stay on one side of the Jordan because it was a fertile land. Remember, they got permission from Moses and then Joshua. And as time went by, these 2.5 tribes realized the danger of not having an altar. There was actually a big misunderstanding that swirled around that. The thing that you have to tip your hat is at least they had enough common sense to know that unless we have an altar, it's not going to be long before we get diverted and we drift. You and I need altars in our own life. Don't shout me down tonight. In the Old Testament, right, the altars actually point to the cross first and foremost. Yet God still looks for special places where he can meet with us, where we can make decisions. And this is critical in response to his revelation. How many of you know that when God deals with us, the point is not just to fill our head with some interesting information. It's to bring us to a decision. That's what good preaching is. It's designed to lead you to a place where you have to decide some things. You're either going to decide for it or against it, but revelation demands a response. Again, preaching is not just dialogue or education or entertainment. Actually, preaching is meant to drive people to their knees, and in our fellowship, unapologetically, the altar call is the climax of our service. It really is the grand finale. You know, the 4th of July, at least
We used to have 4th of July celebrations, right? You have the fireworks that go off and it's cool and there's this little burst here and this little burst here and right, but then it builds in intensity, right? And then you know when the grand finale is there because all the stops are pulled out, right? And, people will go. They'll even show up early to get the best spot. You know, people that are going to stake out their spot, they would be crazy to leave before the grand finale. Like, what are you doing? Oh, I've seen a few fireworks. I saw the fireworks last year, last service, and so, but the grand finale's coming. Oh, you know, I want to, beat everybody out of the parking lot, but the grand finale. Well, you know, no, that doesn't happen, right? Because is all the other stuff, it is leading to the grand finale. And so that's for us in our service, everything leads up to that, is that this gives men and women, both saved and unsaved, a chance to respond to revelation, to make a decision based on what God is saying. 1 Kings 18:21, Elijah came to the people and said, "How long will you falter between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal, follow him." He's bringing those people to a decision, is that you cannot sit on the fence. You're going to make a decision. Deuteronomy 30, verse 19, "I call heaven and earth as witnesses today against you that I've set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life that both you and your descendants may live." We have Joshua 24:15. "If it seems evil to you to serve the Lord, choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." There's three examples right off the bat, and many others where here it is, people are brought to a place of decision. But you know, like any good thing, there's always criticism. So let's think about the criticism of the altar call. You know, you have times where sinners will come or visitors will come, and what is the part that they complain about in the service? You know, "We love this and that about your church." You have some really friendly people. Maybe they like or don't like the music, right? Maybe they like or don't like the preaching, but it's interesting. You know, the part that I just really have a problem with that church is that when bow your heads and there's that call to raise your hand and go forward, and then someone came in my personal space, had the audacity to ask me, "Are you saved? Are you like this is personal between me and God?" And they'd had the audacity to ask me, right? Actually, that criticism comes out of conviction. People don't like to be brought to a place of decision. And it's sad that in many places there is good preaching, actually. There is fine ministry. Yeah? And then all of a sudden, when there's the opportunity to respond, close in a hymn, perhaps say a prayer, all conviction fades away and people leave unchanged. But listen, biblically speaking, preaching demands a response. You know, other people, they write off the altar call as a gimmick or an unnecessary part of the service. They look at it as a good time to get a jump on everybody else and get out of the parking lot first. But listen, if God is going to meet with man, he's going to expect us to do some things. And so in our text, actually, it's an altar building manual, if you will, that God is very precise in his instructions because he wants to be the focus of the spiritual transaction, the heart being touched by God. In other words, God's saying, "Listen, I'm the main part, not getting out to the restaurant early, not, going into the foyer and chatting it up. I'm the main part of the service." So number one is The altar in the text was going to be made from earth. The thought here is that this is common stuff. This is not like the glitziest material on the face of the earth. I'm thinking about my college. I took a trip with a group of my classmates from Yavapai College to London. And so when we were there, we went to Westminster Abbey and St. Paul's Cathedral. And, you know, you have all of this gold and gilded, stuff, candles and this and that. And I had one of my classmates who was just living like the devil, weren't saved at all. And they're just like looking at all this stuff. And they're like, ooh, don't you just feel spiritual here? And then went right out and right back to nonsense. But see, this is the idea of religion and the world is we're going to put our touch on it. But Jesus even said about the Jews that over time they began to put more value on the gold that was on the altar than the altar itself. In Matthew 23:16, you know, one of the wonderful things about the altar call is that you can have one wherever and whenever you want, is that God can show up and meet with people. I've had church services in various places, in a storefront church where, listen, there was no gold, no gilded. I think we maybe had a half step for the altar, if that. And yet in that place, people came and met God, gave their lives to Jesus Christ. And we were pioneering in Kent. There was a number of times that we had to have service in our living room. And you know what? I'd preach behind the coffee table. People would be sitting on the couches and the easy chairs. And you know what? There was that altar between the coffee table and the couch that God could meet with people. See, listen, we don't need the gold, the tapestries, the candles, or the ornate decorations. God is just looking for a place to meet with man. And in fact, the more you begin to fix it up, the less people begin to see God for all the other nonsense. The second thing is that God said, don't use tools at this altar. If you make it of stone, don't adjust it or customize it or make changes to that raw stone. In other words, don't put your human tools on my altar. So why did God say that? Because more things are manufactured at an altar call than any other time. Some people take out the tool of excuse. I'm not that bad. It's like, whoa, whoa, whoa. The pastor could have put your name in the introduction to my beloved so-and-so. Everybody else is at the altar, and Mr. I'm All Right wasn't talking to me is out there whistling Dixie. That's the tool of excuse. Well, you know, I can talk to God at my seat. You absolutely can, but it's different. Just think about how much the pride kicks in. Man, if I go down to the altar, people might think I have problems. Let me just let you in on something. They know you have problems. We all do. The bladder kicks in. So, you know, I got to go to the bathroom. There was a guy, my parents will remember this, Stephanie will remember this, in the devout church, our bathroom was kind of at the back. Every altar call, like without fail, would go back and comb his hair for like an extended length of time. You know, he didn't have much hair to begin with. And the rest of it fell out, but it's like, bro, like that is the only time you can comb your hair is at the altar call? Are you missing the grand finale? The answer was, yes, he was. Others, and maybe not in places like this, fine, upstanding folks such as yourself, but I'm convinced, you know, pinch a baby or pinch a kid. And it's like, I'd go to the altar, but got to take care of Junior. Yeah, again, not in our fine establishment. The comparison game is I know those people down there, it's just a show. And, you know, is God says, don't use tools on my altar. The other thing that we see is that there was no steps. Why? Because unlike, you know, you can see the pyramids in Mexico or the great altars of pagan religion, God's altar of meeting is not a place where man ascends or goes up in pride, but rather is a place where they go down in humility. See, the altar is a place of humility, right? And that's the thing, that's the rub. Why do I have to go down to that altar? I can meet God right here at my seat. You know, one of the things I remember hearing from the early days of our fellowship is all these hippies came in, got saved, came down to an altar. Well, one of them, Janet Foley at the time, Pace and her parents came in, fine, upstanding members of the Prescott community, and for service after service would not come down. And Pastor Mitchell made a decision. He says, nope. If they're going to get saved, they're going to get saved down at the altar just like everybody else. They're no better than them. Well, you know, those dirty hippies, they need it. But, you know, I'm a member of the country club. Well, members of the country club need to humble their pride too. And you know what the good news is eventually Phil and Pat Payson came down to the altar just like everybody else. God touched them. God moved. Thank God that Pastor Mitchell had a backbone to contend for that. And didn't say, you know what, wow, you know, they probably could put more money in the offering plate than these hippies. But he said, no, the altar is crucial. We're not compromising here. You know, when I pray with people outside the church, many times I'll encourage them, you know what, you ought to come to church, and I would just encourage you, you ought to go down to the altar and make it public. Are you saying people can't get saved if they don't come to the altar? I'm not saying that, but there's just something significant about the altar. It's a place of reference, it's a place of meeting, it's a place where our pride is confronted. So let's think of the significance of the altar. There's an example for us as Christians. Abraham served God before there was any law given, right? The law hasn't been given, and yet he walks by faith. He's accounted as righteous. If you understand his life, you have to understand his altars. His relationship with God was linked to his relationship to an altar. That all through Abraham's life, God would speak to him about life and issues that would come up. And it was at the altar that these things would begin to work themselves through. The point is that as believers in Christ, we can't lose this. Listen to me right now, is that we cannot reach a level in our minds of so-called maturity where altar calls for ourselves become rarer and rarer and rarer. Well, that's where I used to go when I was a new convert. You know what I love about Prescott conferences is I see the leaders of our fellowship down at the altar, still responding 40, 50 years later, because you know what? They understand, you know what? I need that reference point. There are a number of altars in Abraham's life. Let's look at them real quick. Number one, there was the altar of revelation, Genesis 12:8. He moved from there to the mountain east of Bethel, pitched his tent with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. And there he built an altar to the Lord and called on the name of the Lord. This was a place where Abraham began to settle God's plan and purpose for his life. He began to settle God's destiny. It was an altar of revelation. I can think of three different places. March 2nd, 1989 was the day that I gave my life to Jesus Christ. And it was probably the next service. It may have even been a Saturday that I publicly responded and confirmed that private decision. That was a place of reference point for me, is that, you know what? I'm serious about serving God. I'm not going back, and I don't care what anybody thinks about me. I'm going to make it public. Think about an altar call, and I've referenced this recently in the 90s in Davao as well. My dad was preaching on Moses and Moses' struggle to go before Pharaoh and confront Pharaoh, and I can't talk, Lord. And God dealt with him. Am I not the one who made the mouth? I remember going to the altar in this building. It would be like going right there and saying, God, I surrender to your call to preach the gospel. God, I don't want to get up in front of people, but God, you're dealing with me. And if you'll help me, I will surrender to that call. And after I left my seat, I went back to my, left the altar. I went back to my seat. And it's like, I don't want to forget this. I wrote in my Bible, I choose to do the will of the Lord. Someone else may have seen that and not knowing what it meant. But for me, every time I open my Bible, hey, don't forget the commitment that you made. Whether it was Davao, Prescott, I would stake out the front row. And the part of the great thing is, number one, a whole lot less distractions. But number two is that you could just fall right off your seat to be right there in the altar space. Listen, Tempe Church, right? We've established the altar call, but future pastor, future pioneers, you're going to have to contend and fight for altar calls in your church services. I mentioned speaking in tongues. That's right. Two Wednesdays ago, you have to fight and contend, but you have to fight for altar calls. It's not something that automatically happens in a church service. You have to preach on it. You have to explain it. You have to sometimes... People are, I'm not coming down. Hey, how about we just all come down front? We'll pray together. Say, are you tricking them? Absolutely. Right? You know, I remember we'd have revival services and you know, in the early days. And it's like, you know, my wife and I are the only ones down there at the altar. And I'm talking to Melanie on the way home. Like, are they not getting it? Like, if you and me need to answer the altar call, they need to be down there. Oh, I wonder how the Seahawks are doing today. You know? But the point is, you contend for it and it'll come. It'll come. God brings that revelation, but that breakthrough won't come if you don't contend for it. You know, secondly, is that there's an altar where you revisit it. Genesis 13, 4, to the place of the altar which he had made there at first. And there Abraham called on the name of the Lord. So are you catching this? Time has passed on in Abraham's life. He wants to rekindle his initial passion. And he goes to the place where he first met God, a place of humility. Listen, this is why, part of why I'm preaching this. We need to come back to the altar. Amen. The Assemblies of God president some time back wrote a book, Back to the Altar, where he challenged his denomination that had drifted from the altar. But listen, if we're not careful, that can happen to us. And again, we're very unique, not the only one, but very few churches give altar calls for Christians where God can meet with them. Right in the early days of our fellowship and in conference, right, there would be, we'd run out of space and people would come up on the stage and pray. If we're not careful, we drift away and no longer think that we need the altar call. The altar also for Abraham was a place of decision. Genesis 13, 18. Abram moved his tent and went and dwelt by the terebinth tree of Mamre, which are in Hebron, and built an altar to the Lord. This is a significant altar. He built this altar right after his nephew Lot separated from him. God said, look to the north, the south, the east, the west. I've given this all to you. It doesn't matter what Lot, your carnal nephew, chose. It's mine to give to you. And the point here, church, don't miss this, is maybe it wasn't easy to separate from Lot. Perhaps Abraham is going through a grieving process. Perhaps he's frustrated. Maybe he's vexed. Whatever the case is, he processed life's experiences at the altar. Listen, life is complicated. Sometimes people that are close to you decide to go another direction, and there are times that you make stands. Say, no, I'm not compromising. I'm not giving in. I'm not going that way. And so like Abraham, he built an altar, worked through the issues and emotions that were raised through the whole situation. And an altar is a place where we work through the situations of life. There are so many things that God can do at an altar that go, thank God for counseling, thank God for encouragement. But I'm telling you, a session with God at the altar probably will save you from a number of counseling sessions. Pastor Mitchell trained us. You got to let people break through and work through issues at the altar. See, the altar is also under assault. Right? Because it's built in response to covenant relationship with God. But Genesis 15, 11, when the vultures came down on the carcasses, Abram drove them away. We have to understand if the altar call is as powerful as I'm making it to be by the word of God, then you better believe it. It will be a target. And again, listen, sometimes preaching is just reminders. If we do not contend and consciously fight for an altar call in our church, we're going to lose something. Here in that passage, it comes through the birds of prey. That's always a picture of demonic forces that begin to attack the altar and the sacrifice that was made at the altar. You have to fight to protect the altar call. So, how do we do that? Well, a number of ways. But number one, we reverence that time and we respond during that time. But I get it. Not every single sermon is always going to elicit a response. I would say if it's sermon after sermon after sermon and there's never a response, I'd be like, let's check our pulse. But there may be one that's just not, then that's a great time to deal with sinners. In other words, it's not like, hey, I wonder what's on offer up. I wonder how the Diamondbacks are doing. I wonder, scope out the menu for where we're going to go eat at lunch. How dare you? Honestly, how dare you? That's an offense. No, that's an offense. It's God's time. It's God's place. Maybe look around. Are there visitors, sinners, someone I could deal with? You know what? Sometimes, you know, it might even be, and I've seen this just even over the last few weeks, is that maybe it's just someone that is at the altar that God puts on your heart. You can go down. You don't have to interrogate them, but maybe just pray. What a blessing. Hey, bro, sis, I'm contending with you and believing God. You know what is, if nothing else, is that it's just a time of prayer and to be in praise, is that we're not getting diverted. And fifth is that the altar is the altar of sacrifice. Genesis 22:9, then they came to the place of which God had told him, and Abraham built an altar there and placed the wood in order and bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar upon the wood. Listen, God does most of his business with us at an altar. It is at an altar where the greatest sacrifices of life are determined. The greatest sacrifices of life are settled. Think about Abraham. This is the son of promise, the one he's been looking for, waiting for, praying for. And yet when God tells him, I want you to bring Isaac and offer him up, he brings him to that altar. He settles it. This would have been the greatest sacrifice of his life. He is putting his future, his hope, his dreams on the altar, and he's setting it in God's hands. So let's look last at sustaining an altar. Three things very quickly is number one, don't let it become a formality, or in other words, ritualistic. Anything that we do again and again, even good things can become cold and calculated. Can become for show. It's like, okay, I'll just go up and down, or you know. But listen, is don't let it become ritualistic. Come down and robo shondo and for a few minutes and hallelujah, hallelujah, look at your fingernails. Okay, have I done my designated time? Is it safe to go back without getting criticized? No. He said, meet with God. If you got to stay there after people are dismissed, praise God. Stay there, meet, amen. Number two, altars have to be repaired. We see this with Elijah in 1 Kings 18:30. Elijah said to all the people, come near to me. So all the people came near to him and he repaired the altar of the Lord that was broken down. See, when altars are broken, the degree of idolatry, backsliding, and immorality greatly increases. But when an altar is repaired, people begin to get their heart right. Right? And this is an indictment from Elijah to the people. He says, you've let the altars break down. You've ignored them. And there's nothing to turn the hearts of man. And because of this, there's great backsliding in the land. So the question for us is, what does our altar look like? What is the condition of the altar in your own life, in your own heart? Are you responding anymore? I mean, you know, and you know, the awesome thing about a tender heart is even if the sermon doesn't exactly get you, there's something to respond to. Right? What does the altar call look like to you? Is it the time to partner with your pastor, with your brethren, or is it the 2-minute warning? Service is almost out. We get to go home. Should be, who can I minister to? What is God saying to my life? And altars are a place where we repent. Matthew 5, 23 and 24. Therefore, if you bring your gift to the altar and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go your way. First be reconciled to your brother and then come and offer your gift. Jesus is making a powerful point here. He said, I can deal with people if they come to the altar. So here's a man at the altar, and it is at the altar where he remembers something or considers something he hadn't thought of before. At an altar, God begins to show things to us and uncover things that have been hidden deep in our heart so that we can get up, like the man in the text, you know, I've got to do something about it. That's what repentance is. I've got to change. And that's what we're after. In this passage, Matthew 5, this man had to find somebody and make things right. That's what an altar's for. If we can get down to an altar, God can do something in our lives and the lives of others. A simple altar call can totally turn things around in a person's life. Remember hearing this story of a pastor invited to a church in Toronto that he knew very little about. He was just visiting, had no connection to it. Preached his sermon and then pulled an altar call as he was accustomed to do. And 7 people responded for salvation. After the service, there was a wife of one of the deacons who came up to him and said, well, we don't believe in altar calls in our church. He's like, oh, well, that's how I do it. Sorry. You know, he's kind of apologetic and went on his way. The next day in another town, he received a call from somebody that had overheard the exchange. Said, I just thought you might want to know, one of those people that responded to the altar call last night went into eternity. Thank God that man had an altar call. Amen. Let's bow our heads all over this place. Thank God for altar calls. Thank God for a place where we can meet with God and God can meet with us. It is a place of decision, but it's a place of help. It's a place of reference point. Hearts and lives change. Destinies change. Very appropriately, we're right at the place that I talked about throughout the sermon, the altar call. And before we go any further, first and foremost, we want to extend it for you. Perhaps you've come into this place tonight you're not right with God. I'm not asking if you're religious or you believe in God. I'm not asking if you're better than the next person. My friend, the Bible tells us all of us, our lives are like a vapor. We are here today, gone tomorrow, and we're going to step into eternity. And if this life is the time that you have opportunity to make it right with God, how do you make it right with God, Pastor Chris? There's only one way. It's through Jesus Christ. He died on Calvary's cross and shed his blood in my place and in yours. And it's only if you come to Jesus where your sins can be forgiven. You can't clean up your life. You can't make yourself, where God will just acceptable in God's sight in your own power. No, it's only through humbling your pride, calling out on the name of Jesus, repenting and turning from your sins, where Jesus can come in and cleanse you. This room is filled with many that have had that encounter. You're here tonight. Listen, it's not an accident. God loves you and he wants to touch you. He can save you, have mercy upon your life. Very simply, all it takes is an honesty that says, you know what? Yeah, I am a sinner. I'm not right with God. Why would I let pride keep me back from the greatest gift in all of time and eternity, and that's salvation, being right with God? You're here tonight. You'd say, Pastor Chris, that's me. I'm not saved. I'm not right with God. Here's my hand. You'd raise it, hold it up high, even right now, where I can see it. Be my honor to pray with you. Hallelujah. God is pulling on hearts and lives. A number of little kids that have responded. Thank God for those hands. You're an adult. You feel the love of God pulling on your heart. Won't you respond? God loves you. I see that hand, dear. God bless you. How many more? How many more? Maybe you're a backslider. And maybe even that's the whole fear is, you know what? I don't want to come clean with that. I've drifted away. But listen, if you'll humble your heart, humble your pride, God can help you. He is a God of second chances. He's a God of restoration. You'd respond. Join these that have already responded. Say, that's me. I'm not saved or I'm backslidden. Here's my hand, Pastor. Would you pray for me? I don't want to leave this room without making it right with God. I just close with a story. A man responds to an altar call, goes into eternity that night. Thank God it's the love of God that draws men and women unto repentance. You have no guarantee of another day. Today is the day. Now is the acceptable time. One last appeal, not holding it out much longer. You'd say, that's me. Not saved or I'm backslidden. I want to respond tonight, Pastor. Here's my hand. Here's my hand. Hallelujah. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. You raised your hand for salvation, man. Would you look up at me? Did you mean that? I believe that you did. Would you come forward? We're going to have somebody pray with. Did you mean that, young man? Come on up. There's a little girl that raised her hand. Mom or grandma, you can deal with her. I need a lady to come. Come on out if you feel God pulling on your heart. You come. Yep. Hallelujah. People are coming. Thank God. God can help honest hearts and lives. Praise God. Turning the order to the saints of God. Listen, is that number one, our first inclination in preaching is, God, what are you dealing with me about? And the altar is the appropriate place to address that. There's something significant coming to an altar. But again, beyond even our own response is maybe we're not responding to that particular sermon. We need to personally and corporately protect the altar call in our action and in our attitudes, in contending, praying for people, dealing with people, sanctifying that time. I'm telling you, thank God that this is part of what's been handed down to us. May God help us to personally protect that, corporately protect that. Praise God. Let's sing out this song. These altars are open. Perhaps God would stir you. You come, you talk to God. You lay hold of heaven. Maybe it's been, God, I've pride, shame, embarrassment, laziness. I've avoided it. I push that off. God, I'm making a commitment, not for show. Listen, this isn't about getting a gold star on the chart, but this is a revelation. You know, perhaps there's even people that you just haven't got it. God, please give me a revelation about what's been preached tonight. Past the outer courts, into the holy place, past the brazen altar, Lord, I want to see your face. Pass me by the crowds of people, sing your praise. I hunger and I thirst for your righteousness, and it's only found in one place. Take me into the Holy of Holies. Take me in by the blood of the Lamb. Take me into the Holy of Holies. Take the coal, cleanse my lips, here I am. Take the coal, cleanse my lips, here I am. Take me past, take me past the outer courts, into the holy place, past the brazen altar. Lord, I want to see your face. Pass me by the crowds, past the priest to sing your praise. Lord, I hunger and I thirst for your righteousness, and it's only found in one place. Take me into the Holy of Holies. Take me in by the blood of the Lamb. Take me into the Holy of Holies. Take the coal, cleanse my lips, here I am. Take the coal, take the coal, cleanse my lips, here I take me in. Take me into the Holy of Holies. Take me in by the blood of the Lamb. Take me into the Holy of Holies. Take the coal, cleanse my lips, here I am. Take the coal, cleanse my lips, here I am. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's stand at this altar space. I think it's only appropriate that we commemorate this in prayer. And again, it's not like there's this, you know, blatant sin that's being addressed or a call to action per se that's being addressed, but just the whole issue of the altar call personally, as a church, as a fellowship, that God, we want to go on record and say, no, this is crucial. This is important. Not that it's just Pastor Chris's thing or Pastor Olson's thing or just what we do at the door. But no, we believe in this, and we're marking it. So I want you to pray with me. Say, Father in heaven, I thank you for the altar, a place of meeting where I can draw near to you in response to the preaching of your word. Lord, help me not to put my human tools on the altar, tools of laziness, excuses, comparison. God, I ask you to help me to keep a humility that would respond when you're pulling on my heart, regardless of what anyone else thinks, regardless of how my pride kicks against it. Because you can help humble people. You resist the proud, but give grace to the humble. God, personally, I want the altar to be a place of revelation. God, speak to me about the issues of my life. Give me a revelation about what was preached tonight. God, I want the altar to be a reference point, a place of decision that I can reference off of and that I can come back to. I recognize there will be an attack on the prayers, the decisions, the commitments that have been made at this altar. But like Abraham, I'm going to fight off the birds of prey that would try to steal the sacrifice off of the altar. And God, I ask you that you would help me to just have a fresh revelation of the importance of this time. Thank you that the altar call has been fought for and contended for by those who have gone before us. But help us to protect this sacred part of our service. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen. Let's give God praise. Lidio do robo coria la mamando robo codo. Lidia la mamanda ya da raba corrie de ke dia. Shirie kebe ke de rebe ke de coa. Ya la manda ya la mamando robo corrie de kea. Lebe ke de rebe ke de rebe ke de. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Created is at these altars that you have heard about tonight. It is those times when I myself am coming to meet with you. Man meeting with God, a woman meeting with God. It is my place where I meet with you, says God, to commune with you, to speak with you, to become your guidance and your direction, to order your steps, says God. It is these times that I cherish with you, says God. Do not despise the altar. Do not treat it as a light thing, says God. But it is my time with you, says God. Will you cherish that time? Those times I will guide you and direct you in your life. Those destinies that you seek, those problems that you're encountering, saith God, I can remedy those with my word that will be quickened to you at this altar. Those times when I'm with you, saith the Lord, when there will be a breaking of bondages, when there will be a deliverances from the works of the enemy that come against your mind, will only happen at the altar where my presence comes upon you and you meet with me and I meet with you, saith God. Do not despise or treat it as a light thing, saith God. It is not a trifling thing, but it's a holy place between you and me, saith the Lord thy God. And then it's a great place to come and to cherish and to love, saith the Lord thy God tonight.
Amen. Halalababa robo kudu. Yidi alalama manda raba kuria da rabaka. Yede kuria alalababa rababa kaya da. Halalamanda ririanda ramamamanda. Praise God. Thank God. Amen. I want to encourage you that you sanctify it. And, you know, I mentioned Elijah. Don't let your altar fall into disrepair. The good news is as he repaired that altar, right, fire fell from heaven once again. Amen. It was an outpouring. Amen. God met. And so if that is the issue, don't despair. The altar can be repaired. And it can be a meeting place once again. But again, this is something. It's critical that you have a revelation. because there's people that your lives are going to touch, and they're going to come in and like, man, what's the altar call all about? And it's helpful to be able to explain to them. Don't in any way, it's never good. Well, that's just the way we do it at the door. Okay, but why? Right? And so this can be a reference point to point out some things of, hey, this is why we do this. And this is what's behind this, because this is a critical thing. Like I said, it's been fought for, contended for. And you know what? You don't want to be the person, I just want to jump on everybody else. Really? For five minutes and you're leaving before the grand finale. Amen. So let's be dismissed. Amen. A lot of different things. The youth rally going up to Prescott Saturday morning, if you're not signed up for that, youth. And then local outreaches tomorrow night, Tempe Town Lake, 10:30 outreach. And then no concert this week, but movie at Kiwanis Park, 6:30. Praise God. Let's bow our heads. We're going to be dismissed across this place. And if I could have Nate Blanco just lift his voice, close us in prayer.
Father God, we thank you for the privilege of meeting at your altar, Lord God. We're asking that you would help us, Lord God, to go home safely, Lord God, to come back on Sunday, Lord God. Help us to see fruit, Lord God, from our labors. We thank